Then your business is confirmation of the agenda. Would you like to move that, Barbara? Thank you. John? Discussion? All those in favor? Carried. Adoption of minutes, be resolved the council approved the minutes from the October 18, 2014 council meeting as presented. Would you like to move? John, thank you. See your hand there, oh, there we go, Barbara, thank you. Discussion? All those in favor? Carried. Committee of the whole. Be resolved the council recessed special council meeting at 9:01, 2:00, 9:00 AM, so. Move into committee of the whole meeting to allow for fuller discussion regarding 2018 capital budget workshop. Who would like to move that? Christine and Barbara, discussion? All those in favor? Carried. Be resolved the committee appoint someone as chair of the committee of the whole meeting on October 31st, 2017. Who would like to make that motion? Christine, John? Go ahead, John.
Okay. I'd like to appoint Anna Marie Fallbrook as the chair of the committee of the whole meeting on October 31st.
John, second? Barbara, discussion? All those in favor? Carried. And now we have the large report, Finance 2017-053. Be resolved the committee recommends the council receives staff report Finance 2017-053 as information. Who would like to move that? Jim? And John? Now we will have much discussion. Good morning, Liam.
Good morning. So I think we should go into the presentation, the PowerPoint presentation. Attachment A.
Do you want to be able to make it yourself? Mark, I'll follow.
Well, I'll let you move down.
Okay. No, that's.
Okay. So, in the next slide. So in the township of Southgate, for the 2017 budget, we discussed capital and operating all at the, basically integrated and combined. So this, the 2018 capital budget, 2018 budget process, we decided to first deal with capital and then deal with operating. So in this presentation deals with just the 2018 capital projects and capital project and special project. So in 2017, capital and special project tax levy was $1,447,896. And the presentation anticipates a levy of $1,507,770 for a $60,000 increase or 4.1%. So since the overall levy in 2017 was $5,669,214, the $59,000 would equate to about 1.1%. So I just want to stress that those are sort of ballpark numbers at this point until we actually get into the operating budget to know what the ending over impact is. So just to remind, so 1% of the overall levy is about $57,000. So that's why the $59,000 increase is approximately 1.1% increase. So a 1% increase to the capital and special project levy is about $14,500. 1% overall is $57,000. And as I said, $9,874 would be 1.1% overall. So I'm just presenting that just to sort of keep, so you have it in your head as to how much of an impact that each dollar change may or may not have if you so choose to make that change.
Could you just repeat, is this going to actually work? Could you also just repeat that, what, 14.5 and that equals 1% of the capital?
Yeah, capital levy in 2017 was $1,447,000.
Yes.
So 1% of that is about $4,500.
So if I may, the capital and special projects, are all of the special projects capital?
And this is another change I've done for 2018. In last year, all the capital and special projects were sort of grouped together. And in 2018, they're to get, they've been identified separately within this presentation. So you have capital projects and then special projects. So the distinction is capital projects would be items that you would capitalize on the balance sheet for PSAV, whereas special projects are really an operating cost. But they're like sort of a one-time project or item. So they're not, you don't repeat them every single year. You only do them once every so many periods.
So as much as they're one time, we cannot categorize them from the county perspective as a capital expense.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Traditionally, capital projects of a township have been really one-time items, but now I'm trying to distinguish between what is a capital item versus an operating item, that it is a one-time item.
Thank you.
And we'll move to the next slide. So, in tax supported, the intent of the current presentation is to discuss the level of tax funding for 2018 capital and special projects. For 2018, we've done a 10-year capital and special project forecast listed by specific projects, whereas in the prior year we only had a 5-year forecast. And the approach when I was developing multi-year forecast was to attempt to smooth the increase in the capital and special projects to between 2 and 3% a year, if whenever possible, except in the roads, which I went with 6% due to the cost pressures in that department. So the part on the right-hand side of the slide shows what the requirement from taxation is by a department basis, administration, public health, council, etc. It's coming down to the $1.5 million requirement in 2018. And we'll get into each for future slides sort of discusses those individual lines further.
If I may, at what point do we anticipate the reconciliation of actual capital expense spent in 2017?
In the presentation, you have a projected 2017 capital, and for an actual, you'll have to wait until February of 2018.
Okay. So, where, as an example, where we received funding that we previously might have budgeted for capital expense, we're going to see the reconciliation of that when we see the final actual in February 2018.
Hopefully I will have projected, if I know something's come in that wasn't on budget or not on budget, it should be projected that way, and then I won't know the final number until February 2018. So we'll move to the next slide. So tying into the asset management plan and financing strategy within that, the current asset management plan that was approved March 13, 2014, which reflects roads, bridges, storm facilities, water and wastewater assets, and the financial strategy in that plan required an increase in the overall tax levy of 4.93% each year for 20 years, which would eliminate the infrastructure gap of the township. So since that plan has...
I'm sorry, I got distracted. You have to repeat that last part. Eliminate the deficit?
The infrastructure gap, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So your fund from taxation to a sufficient level to replenish your assets on the basis that you should be replenishing them.
I guess I'm going to ask you to read that statement again, just to be clear. What's the impact on this gap?
If you had followed the plan starting in 2014 or the 2015 budget and raised taxation by say 5% a year,
mm-hmm,
for 20 years, you would have eliminated the infrastructure gap.
Okay, so had we done this starting 2014-15, we would have eliminated the infrastructure gap.
If you had increased the overall tax levy by 5% every year for 20 years.
For 20 years.
That was what the financing strategy in that plan. I believe council received that plan. It didn't implement that plan. Which follows with, since the receipt of that plan, the only nominal changes in the capital tax levy has occurred in the last couple of years. So essentially keeping it to 1% or zero. I believe 1 year went 5%, the other year went down 5%. So that's why I'm saying it's nominal, essentially no change. So for 2018, The current presentation anticipates a 4.1% increase in the capital tax levy, which equates to a 1.1% increase in the overall tax levy. So we're only 21% of the increase required for the financing strategy. So 4.1% increase is only 21% of the 15% that the financing strategy would have anticipated. Or vice versa, 1.1% is only 21% of the 4.93%. Would you like me to go through that again? But I think I just spewed out a lot of numbers.
Sure.
So the current presentation anticipates a full increase in the overall tax levy of 1.1% for 1.1% of the overall levy for capital and special projects, which is only compared to the 4.93% that the financing strategy would have required to eliminate your infrastructure cap. It's only 21% of that increase. So 1.1%, 1.1 is only 21% of 4.93%.
Through the chair, Liam, then when you say overall tax levy on the page,
yes.
Is that capital and special projects?
That includes capital and special projects as well as operating.
Thank you. So the 1.1% that this represents as an increase is
mm-hmm.
capital and special projects,
mm-hmm.
which would leave 3.8% operating. If we were to say, let's say 4.93%, we just approved this,
mm-hmm.
we would have 3.8% to work with on operating. Because you're saying
no.
The whole budget, what the financing strategy would recommend that it be 4.93% increase.
For capital funding only.
So it's not overall with operating.
No, it doesn't reflect the increase in the operating.
Sorry, that's what I'm trying to.
4.93% increase in the overall levy would be to only create additional capital funds in order to shrink your infrastructure gap.
Thank you.
So by only raising 21% of that, you're actually increasing your infrastructure gap rather than closing it.
Okay, so I think the confusion is your impact on the overall tax rate. So that number includes operating, you just explained.
Yes. And the reason I'm including that is because typically at the end of the budget, when you integrate capital and operating together, you focus on what the blended tax rate increase is going to be. So effectively, it's 1.1%.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm sure we will go over this again. So.
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Barbara. So that's what I asked you, because I heard you say 4.9% is the overall tax levy required for capital, special projects, and operating. Then you said no, it's only for capital. And I just heard you respond to the mayor, is yes, it includes operating. So you're going to have to start this one again, because...
Okay, so 4.93%, if the overall levy went up by 4.93%, that would be only for the capital component only.
Okay. And that's what I wrote.
I take that along
there.
Okay. It'll all come together.
Yeah. So the next. Do you want to focus on public works before we get into the other comments, or shall we just go over?
Okay. So if you're going to advance, well, I do have a question on this. So the asset management plan. What is the function of the road need study? Because my understanding is we weren't necessarily relying on the asset management plan as much as the roads need study. We seem to be migrating toward the asset management plan, and where does that leave the information in the roads need study where there's differences in one report to the other?
The roads need study would feed into the asset management plan?
Right.
So there's a change in the roads need study. That change should be flowed into the asset management plan.
Okay. So does that mean going forward, we don't need to look at the roads need study when we review the asset management plan and the impact on the budget?
I would say no, because the asset management plan incorporates the key pieces of that capital needs study.
Okay, great. do have a couple other notes on this slide, so just give me a moment.
Maybe while you're doing that, to be complimentary to the asset management plan, Rosemead study is basically in the asset management plan with factors like risk taken into account and the demands on the service. So it just enhances what the Rosemead study is providing.
So in other words, Rosemead study is data and the asset management plan is information and what you need to do with it and what's going to happen if you don't?
Well, it quantifies that in that maybe there is, the Rosemead study may say there's two projects that are in high demand. Like the quality of the infrastructure is low. But if there's a higher risk on project A versus project B, obviously do project A first because there's more impact to the public. Whereas project B maybe can wait for years because it's a little side road that is only used for minimal transportation use.
Thank you very much. So the third bullet point, all nominal changes in the capital tax levy has occurred in the last couple of years. Having looked back at the tax increases in the previous term, I guess, you know, this question comes to mind every year. And Liam, you weren't here, so perhaps Dave can help to fill in the blank. Liam has just explained that had we implemented higher rates following the March 2014 asset management plan, that clearly we would be further ahead. But for the previous 4 years, like, there really hasn't been any significant change with the exception of last year, the notable increase in capital expense. Right, Dave?
Well, I'm not sure we've ever got close to where we need to be or should be. I'm not sure the word is should be because, you know, we've got infrastructure that is being depreciated, and so we're comparing capital projects to depreciation. But at the same time, we're also doing operational things to, you know, support, improve, and manage that infrastructure. You know, so I would be careful comparing past years because I'm not sure there's a municipality. On average, all municipalities are challenged by this, and I'm not sure the taxpayer can afford or needs to completely eliminate that infrastructure gap. That may sound a bit strange, but I think there's a lot of, you know, back roads that are maybe said to need improvements, but they're providing the service, there's limited risk, and I'm not sure the taxpayer can afford to manage that infrastructure gap. So I think through proper maintenance activities and so on, you know, using our Rosemead study and our asset management plan to analyze the risk and the public impacts and the level of service required, I think that's where, you know, maybe we need to take a look at the level of service and reduce some levels of service. There's lots of people closing bridges or closing roads that limited use. So, you know, we have to do this with an eye on what the public can afford as well.
Thank you for that.
Barbara,
do you have
that? Through the chair, to your point, Dave, what I read from like presentations at Roma, and the gap is increasing. What you explained to me, Liam, was that by taking less than what we need to just hold the line on our infrastructure gap, we are actually falling behind. And to Dave's point, you know, should we close that gap completely, like be 100% in line? Or, but at the very least, we need to take increases that will help us to maintain and slightly improve that gap. To take an 8 or 10% increase a year just make sure that in 20 years we have no infrastructure gap. I don't think anybody could sustain that. But what you're saying is that by holding to COLA or less or just slightly above, we've actually fallen behind even the maintaining of that gap. Yes or no?
Go ahead.
I wouldn't say falling behind. I think we're maintaining. If we're falling behind, I think you'd be getting phone calls about complaints about infrastructure. And we're not getting, there's bridges falling apart. We're keeping up. I think we've got an opportunity ahead of us when the tax base increases with our growth. For if we were we were going backwards in population and tax base, that would be very, very challenging. But, we'll do the tax increase you want to do. I think the bigger challenge is keeping our eye on making sure we increase according to I think that will help us catch up and do better if that's what we want to do. But, do we want to be covering our infrastructure gap? Not sure we can afford to.
William? Part of the asset management plan is it's not only the dollars, the financing piece of it. In order to close the infrastructure gap, there's finance is a piece of that. Yes, you need to raise more money, but you also need to revisit your life cycle of your assets. Like the original estimate might be your vehicle's going to last 10 years, but you actually get 12 years out of it. So that's the way of shrinking the infrastructure gap as well, by getting 12 years use out of an asset instead of 10. Or putting down a different kind of pavement than you have in the past that's going to last longer. So there's, as well as maybe closing a bridge and eliminating an asset, another way of closing your infrastructure gap.
Okay.
So the 4.93% is basically if you only raise the dollars to shrink that gap. But there's other ways to shrink the gap as well.
Julian?
So in the administration department, the 2018, originally the phone system, last year the phone system was anticipated for 2019. However, we have had some significant issues with its reliability in 2017, so we have moved that into 2018. The recommended software has been loaded into the 2018 budget, which was not presented previously. In order to sort of compensate for that additional requirement in taxation dollars, we've delayed the replacement and the replacement of computers by 1 year to 2019 in order to try and smooth the requirement. So that's why you'll see in the administration department, it's actually a 104% increase, or $18,000 or 104% increase of that department's piece of the capital levy.
I'm looking for 104.
The minus the 2018 budget, 104.
Yeah.
Yeah. So in 2017 we raised $37,000, and in 2018 we're just being raised $48,000.
I'm sorry, you have there, Robert? Sorry, you said 2017,
$37,000? Yeah, I'm sorry, I pulled the wrong number. So 2017, we raised $18,500, and in 2018, this budget presentation is raising $37,875. So on this department alone, it's 104% increase. 104% of the administration's piece of the capital levy.
Okay, so what we don't see here is three bullet points in the category. What is the anticipated expense of each of those components?
How much? Those are provided in the attachment B.
Okay.
So
we don't have to jump around.
No, I'll just jump to it. I'll tell you what the.
Okay.
Article 79 of Attachment C. So on that page, it shows we have record transmission software of $17,620 and a phone system for $30,000.
Okay, so when we say annual replacement of computers, that is annually we look to replace the computers that need to be replaced. So how many computers are we putting on?
Well, on average, we probably replace, say, 4 computers a year.
Okay.
So we will just delay those 4 computers for 1 year. We feel that the computers themselves are less critical than the phone system, so we've delayed that a year.
So on average, we replace 4 computers per year, and how many computers do we have on the go that need to be replaced regularly? What's the ballpark estimate of computers out there?
In the administration, there's about 15 or 16.
So we're replacing them once every 4 years?
About that, yeah.
Okay.
So we'll move on.
I apologize. Before we move on, this has some interesting information about the future years. So just looking ahead to, there's no huge jumps from year to year on this chart. I'm scanning it again because there were others that some of them jumped up. So it looks like from this point forward, we're going to have twice the expense and capital and special projects every year for the next 10 years.
Right now, yes. Right now, the forecast anticipates, the crunch really is in the next couple of years of projects that we know about. So in future years, I've reflected a contribution to an infrastructure reserve, as we don't know what those projects are yet, knowing that this administration building is aging and will require some sort of repairs probably in the next 10 years, but that's not loaded right now. So the budget shows a contribution to reserves until that is known. So that's how this army got moved to the 2.2% from 2021 on.
Thank you.
Okay.
Yep.
So in public health, the only capital expenditure actually reflects is shown in 2027, where there's a anticipated medical clinic to be built. All the other years is basically a special project because you're making contributions to other organizations, being the Markdale Hospital, the Northwest Hospital, and the Durham Medical Clinic or Hospital. So this reflects that right now we're raising in 2017 we raised $68,000 for those projects. And then the 2018 was the last year of the new Markdale Hub commitment, which was $400,000. Mm-hmm. That amount has now been raised through taxation and put away into a reserve. And I will just comment that finishes the existing commitment of $4,000 to the hospital. I personally would anticipate probably them come back to council and probably asking for a much higher number. That has not occurred yet. So this only reflects your finishing collecting the dollars for the existing commitment that you have, as well as this is the last year for the Mark Hospital Cancer Cardiac Expansion Commitment. That was $40,000 that is still away to reserve because that expansion has not happened.
So without one is Schedule B, what's the anticipate? You said the 2017 1.5 largely reflects the establishment of the medical clinic reserve?
The 2017 expenditure of $1.5 million, that's the amount we're anticipating a medical clinic in Dundalk. So that's in the previous year's budget. Once those commitments fall away, I have those dollars being put away into a reserve to reduce the requirement for taxation in 2027 for the medical clinic.
And
mm-hmm.
So how many other municipalities get their own medical clinic? Is that something that is done? I know there are clinics in other municipalities, but I'm wondering, do they own them, or are they owned by other entities?
Maybe I'll comment on that one. You know, we're a bit unique, as we don't have a hospital in town, and in the past, the Lions Club has taken the lead on that. I think where we're at, you know, we've got a clinic with them. It's aging. It's not as accessible maybe as it could be, and we think we just need to start budgeting for something that would bring all the services that are in Dundalk. I mean, we've got the Erskine Church facility going with Southeast Grey Community Health Center, but somewhere down the road, I think those facilities, we need to be prepared to bring them together. There really isn't any other lead. I'm sure when we get there, there'll be some partnership with Alliance Club or a community group like that, but if we start now, we'll have something when we go to build it. Or we may reorient, something may step up, but it's become apparent that municipalities need to control this because the Ministry of Health is not.
Thank you, Dave Barber.
Part of my question was answered. With regard to the medical clinic, understanding that the existing medical clinic is aging. So we have, and we own that building, or the Lions own that building?
The Lions.
Can we afford to wait 10 years with the growth, and are we going to be able to provide medical clinic services without one?
That's a good question. And I think we're going to have to, you know, figure that out in the next 2 or 3 years. And see, you know, see how the community grows and what the needs are. But to me, you know, the vision, we've talked about vision of a community facility. And when we bring that together, that needs to be, in my mind, not only a facility that serves cultural and recreational, but also services that medical piece, that hub piece. Support services to the community of one place.
Just wanted to clarify, in 2018, we have right now 21,500 being projected to go into the medical clinic reserve. So that's really the only change in the current year really is that piece. And the fact that we've voted the medical clinic in 2027, it just sort of put it on the horizon that it's being considered and discussed, and whether or not it's the right number or the right year, or whether or not there's a partnership plan, like that's going to be an ongoing discussion that has been said. So the only impact of 2018 alone is putting aside $21,000 into a medical clinic reserve, which, again, my first item, I would think that the town would probably contribute some funds to a medical clinic, but if not, they build it or somebody else build it. So, and the only one $21,000 was the current year budget for it.
Okay, so to make sure I've got this straight, you're saying that of the 69,500, right?
Yep.
21,000 is going to go towards a reserve for
21,500. Yeah, up to 69,500. 21,500 is to go into a medical clinic reserve.
Okay, so medical clinic reserve, and that is a new reserve account.
Yes.
And it will only be established in 2018.
Yes.
Thank you.
And the reason that I've loaded it that way is, again, the commitment to Markdale Hospital has been completed, so that has left $20,000 that would have come off the table otherwise. So I put that away into a medical clinic reserve.
Thank you.
So if there's no further questions, we'll move on to the next slide. So in council, for council special projects, special project is going to be an election in 2018, as well as means of the... Oh, the clerk didn't know that, apparently.
Okay, then.
As well as we're anticipating replacing the council iPads at the end of the year, as existing iPads are
Jerry, you and I had a conversation about BlackBerry, and something serious happened to mine recently, which through contacting BlackBerry, which they don't support, and then contacting Bell, I learned that effective January 1st, 2018, BlackBerry is no longer going to supporting BlackBerry Classic 10OS, which is what we have. So I don't see for the new council phones. Maybe, I don't know if that is, you know, we go back to the technology allowance as rather than supplying the phone, but if it keeps doing what it's doing, it's only going to be a telephone.
Just to respond to that, by and large, that's an operational thing. As far as changing over, there might be a fee of $100 to upgrade or something, but we should deal with that in operations.
So really the only observation I made on this particular slide was, could we do a better job of amortizing the hit of the cost of the elections over a course of 4 years rather than waiting for the election?
And that's what we started doing, in 2016, we put away $5,000, 2017, we put away $10,000, and in 2018, we're having a hit of the taxation of $10,000 because of the election, and that's putting away $10,000 a year, so it does smooth it going forward.
So going forward,
so we started that last year.
So going forward, you're looking to not have any significant variance as relates to election expense to be amortized over the term?
Yes.
Okay. I made a note about training, but that's all right.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So next slide. So in the planning department, the 2017 requirement taxation was $19,500. That's what we're anticipating this year and essentially all future years. There's some heavier loading of official reviews in 2018 due to the zoning bylaw review, official plan review, community improvement plan, the action plan, the urban expansion study, as well as the municipal servicing standards. So you'll see that line in the expenditure column. You'll see like $85,000 compared to the $43,000 projected for the 2017. And essentially, in 2019, no money being spent, but we're assuming essentially the allowing is for smooth operational costs. Essentially, a cost of $19.5 million into reserves every year. And as these one-time reviews or once every four-year reviews come up, that will come out of that operating reserve. So there is no capital projects in capital projects in planning. I think they're all special operating projects.
Yes. So what you said is you're taking 19.5 and putting into reserves every year for this category.
Yes.
And that money is going to fund these special projects.
Yes. Because every so many years you're going to have to update your zoning, you're going to have to your official plan, your action plan. But if they're going to be each one is going to be say once every 4 years, or every 5 years, 4 or 5 years.
So again, are you looking to smooth out the impact of this by the time we get to 2019, I'm a little confused, you got some blanks.
Well, this one essentially is smooth, because that's why you're already raising 19.5, and I'm proposing to continue raising 19.5. So that's why you see a 0% increase every year, or a 0% change.
Okay.
From a requirement for taxation, it's been leveled off.
Okay. So more surprises in that category at this rate of investment in our reserves.
That's correct.
Through the chair, Liam, if we're to do these on a more, you know, every 4 or 5 years, why in 2023 is it only $25,000, but in this year it's $85,000? Shouldn't there be a large hit? And then again in 2027, perhaps?
I mean, over to the clerk on that one.
Official plan, you've got zoning bylaw amendment, site update, provincial policy statement, we'll have that.
I would tend to agree, and the fact that the expenditure obvious hasn't listed in the future year coming from taxation.
Or, if I may, or we could even that as well by not having all six items done at the same time, they're going to kind of be done over the next 3 years.
Maybe I'll just jump in here. Some of this is being supported by DCs as well, because some of these updates or community action plan, the improvement plan, or some of that's in DC. So we collect in DCs to reduce the tax burden.
Can you tell me what page I could look at Schedule E for the numbers that relate to this?
The details of that $85,000 on page 20 of 79, attached B, where you'll see the list of $85,000 worth of projects. And further to Dave's point, there's $49,500 of that, included by DC.
Okay.
Sorry, not all DC, it's 45,000.
Well, I was just going to mention also that at the top of the page with the planning list schedule, it says B5, and that's 20 and 21 of 79 and onward.
So the zoning bylaw review and the official plan review has started. We've spent 3,000 on that, correct? According to page, unless I'm missing it, which is highly possible, page 20 and 79.
Page 20 of 79 is the 2018 budget. If you look at 2017, you go to the page before, on page 19 of 79, where we budgeted to do $20,000 on the official plan, and we were projecting not to get that official plan done in 2017. So we zero our expenditure on that.
So the 20,000 we're not spending.
In 2017, $20,000 is not being spent. In 2017, it's being spent in 2018.
So where we're budgeting for expenses that we're going to recoup through DCs, we're budgeting them, but we're going to get the money back. So the reconciliation of that, you will show us at the year end that relates to.
I will show you the projection actual at year end. But if you look at page 20 of 79, you'll see of the $85,000 worth of special projects, $35,500 is being funded by our own unrestricted reserves, and $49,500 is being funded by DC.
So if I go back to the PowerPoint slide relating to this, and I see the $85,000, then, without flipping back, you said 35 of that, give or take, we're going to recover in DC.
We're going to fund the $85,000 with $35,000 worth of reserves, and of unrestricted planning reserves, as well as $49,000 worth of restricted DC reserves. So essentially that $85,000 is being fully funded. Taxation is not funding those $85,000 in the current year because we've put away reserves in the prior year.
Well, at some point, it's a wash or close to it based on how much we recover in DCs. So what I'm saying is, at what stage will we see the reconciliation of that? Because we're saying you're going to budget for $85,000, but in fact, we're not going to be spending net $85,000.
Well, you would see at the end of 2018, there will be a project similar to page 19 of 79. You'll see that in 2017, we plan to do $20,000 worth of projects. And I'm projecting to not do the project that was budgeted for, but for doing an EC study instead, and an addendum. So you'll see what we project to do at the end of 2018, and then the actual is early 2018.
Okay. Okay, you know what, I think maybe I was confused with your reference to these fees, because I'm thinking, and maybe I just need to go back to the root question. The projects that you've highlighted here, our official plan as an example, we can in fact, that is a DEC recoverable expense.
Correct.
Okay.
Some of it, yes.
Okay, so as we look at these six categories, which of them are not a DEC recoverable expense? Because I thought they all were.
They all have a DEC recoverable component to it.
Okay.
So if again, look at page 20 of 79.
Mm-hmm.
The zoning bylaw review, $10,000, that project is anticipated cost.
Mm-hmm.
$4,500 of it can be recovered through DCs. So therefore, we're funding the remaining $5,500 through the planning reserve,
mm-hmm.
of which we've put me aside in prior years for.
Okay, well, I'm sure we'll flush out. Barbara?
So just to clarify, restricted reserve, that's where the DC money that we collect goes. And this 19.5 that we're going to take from taxation and put in reserves would be in the unrestricted reserve for very all these projects. So the portion that's recoverable from DCs is already being collected and put into the restricted reserves.
Yes.
Thank you.
So I'm looking at page 19 of 79, and I just need to understand the way this works. We've got official plan review phase 2, $20,000. That was not spent, correct?
Correct.
And so I just saw expenditure. That is just what was projected to spend in, as far as the budget goes. There's no real actual here, is there?
Right. We budgeted to spend $20,000, and I'm saying we're not spending.
Right, and so that's transferred to reserve, 19.5,
right? No, 20,000. Okay, 2017 budget anticipated that full $20,000 to come from reserves. We didn't spend any money, so therefore that money just stays in reserves. We don't touch the reserve.
Okay, so there was no, we weren't raising any money for taxation for the official plan. We just planted it from the official plan review. We just planted it from reserves, don't you think?
We raised. Each year we have a transfer to planning and zoning reserves of $10,000. So every year we put away $10,000. So we're taking that money out. We were anticipating taking that money out in 2017.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not taking it out in 2017. We're taking it out in 2018 instead.
Okay.
So back to the PowerPoint. Community Action Plan and Community Improvement Plan. So, Dave, I'm not sure if you're aware, there's some discussion at the county about a county-wide community improvement plan. I can't tell you a timeline or how that would work, but I just thought I'd mention that. And then, so what do you anticipate we're going to be doing in relation to Community Action Plan as relates to slide?
Well, that will be a decision for council, but the community action plan will it come to an end 2018, so I think it will be a decision of this council through discussions with staff next year to decide are we going to go through this plan's entire year and leave it to the next council to go through that process of dialoguing, discussing, meeting with the community to figure out what a 2019 and beyond community action plan would look like, or is staff going to do that engagement in 2018 or 2019? So those are all discussions that we need to have as to whether to do it internal, external, and the timing.
And municipal servicing standards, we just recently established updated municipal servicing standards. So what are we doing now?
That would be really the municipal service standards is a living document. We just updated a component of it. At some point next year. Maybe we'll not need to upgrade it, but the idea is more comprehensive review of the entire plan or standard. But it is a living document, and we do upgrade it from time to time with new information.
So given the development that we've got on the go and approved, what would prompt us to update our municipal servicing standards? Who would alert us that we need to? Triton?
Yes, or new technologies that present themselves that we don't utilize right now. Jim will maybe add to that.
Yeah, currently the last big review in June of last year, 2016, included LED lighting. And with the retrofit program that we went through, and we had changed that vote too, because we're 3,000 Kelvin units for lighting. And we were able to, both developers had put in 4,000K in their submission, which was to the standard, but because when we did retrofit, we were at 3,000K. So we are already anticipating bringing back a revised version with just a few minor adjustments, one of them being the 3,000K. So again, FLATO being the project that's still ongoing, and knowing that, but other development that comes here along very shortly, if they look at our servicing standard, it doesn't reference 3,000K. So we've got to capture that. There is some minor revisions coming sooner than later.
Thank you. Was there anything else notable on that slide, then?
No, I think we covered the key pieces.
Thank you.
So, industrial land, I'll start with 2017. They anticipated to sell potentially a $1.1 million parcel and put that into reserves, which I believe was 100. So the projection for 2017 is actually to sell $145,000. The largest parcel sale is now being anticipated for 2018. So we anticipate to, the rent requirement for taxation in 2017 was $52,715. So we've revised it, so the requirement for taxation is zero in 2018 and up until 2021, or 2020, and that goes to $25,000 in 2021, where it's anticipated we'll have to start assembling potential land for a future industrial. So in the next few years, we're not anticipating we're up for taxation, because we already have the inventory of land to sell and be putting into a reserve. So in 2018, we anticipate doing the Highway 10 bypass road engineering design, phase one construction, funding by the industrial land reserve from sales, as well as the separate sale of large parcels in 2017 did not occur in rebudgeted. And Rockies is one of the industrial land reserves. So there's no impact to taxation, but there is an impact to some expenditures.
So what is in that industrial land? How much land, how much money did we sell, or how much money did we get from the land we sold in 2017? And what are you anticipating as far as sales goes for 2018? And where is that reserve sitting right now?
In 2017, I believe the budget anticipated the sale of three parcels, and we actually sold two, or we anticipate having two completed before the end of the year, and the third being completed in 2018. So we budgeted to sell $1.1 million worth in 2017, and we're projecting $145,000.
Do we have any actual numbers on those? Anywhere near the 1.1 million? I'm curious how close they are.
That's $145,000. Two sales are essentially either, I think one's complete and the other is almost complete. So those two sales together are about $145,000.
So we anticipated selling $1.1 million worth of land, is that correct?
We budgeted to sell $1.1 million worth of land.
Okay, we sold 145, but there's a large sale coming in 2018 we are anticipating, and what is that ballpark? Do you know what that is?
In the 2018 budget, we have a budget of $1 million, a sale of $1 million for land.
And is that a firm sale? I'm confused because I'm hearing, and it doesn't want you to confuse me with these things. I'm hearing we anticipated selling $1 million of land in 2017. We sold 145. Is there a sale on the book? How much is it for? Is there something pending right now?
So there is a sale on paper that has been written up, subject to a process. So that's some zoning and concept designs. We've been working with GRCA to lay out concepts of the project. So we anticipate it will close in 2018 when that all that process goes through. It's just going to take time.
Do we have an idea of how much that will be?
Yeah, I think Liam said $1 million.
Is that what I heard?
Yes, $1 million is anticipated for 2018.
Just for the one parcel is what you're suggesting. What, one sale?
Yes.
So the Highway 10 bypass road, Roberta, something here?
Yeah, so V6, page 25 of 79, has the 2018 capital project on it.
25,
right?
Yeah.
Page 25 of 79, of attachment B.
Okay, so can you walk me through what we set aside and what we expect this project will cost right here?
We don't anticipate these projects to cost rate payers at all.
Walk me through that.
There's costs when we sell the land, and then the cost that occurred to complete the sale will come out of the proceeds of the sale. And the remainder is anticipated to go into an industrial land reserve. And that reserve that we're using to help fund the Highway 10 bypass.
Okay, so the reason that I ask is because I know that there was a discussion at one point about the possible concept, I'm looking at Dave, of selling that land and having a developer develop the road. So what we're talking about here is we're going to take the proceeds from the sale of the industrial park land and fund the road.
Yes, that's correct. Because some of the roadway is not on the industrial park land on Highway 10, so we need to get the road there. We could stop that point partway through and say, okay, now we've got the services to the edge of the project. We've got an approved EA and a design, and we could sell it to that point. We can continue on and construct. But any investment in that land is building asset value of the whole property to where we're then, we're going to have an urban study to justify the property being in the urban footprint and so on. So that's just building value of the ultimate sale of the land on a per acre basis.
So before I go to Christine, there have been there's been new information in relation to the route that the road will likely take or will need to take. So just so I have a vision of this, we own that land. Do we own all of the land all the way through that proposed circuitous route?
Yes.
Okay. So when we're done with this road, we're going to be able to offer more parcels fronting on this road, like we're expanding the capacity of available land for sale.
Correct. We'd be providing access to the entire acreage there would be some of the road turned into like a Highway 10 kind of service road. We wouldn't develop it to more to the northerly portion. That would be for a developer to, or for us to develop in the future, but that would be a, another phase that would give you frontage onto Highway 10, yet access from the back of the property is kind of traditional, because you can't get access off Highway 10 to every little business along the highway.
Okay, so I guess what I'm wondering is, we have a finite amount of land available for sale right now in the industrial park.
Yes.
And then with the vision of the road, how much more saleable land do you expect that that's going to give us? New parcels, whatever.
About 140 acres less the land that would be consumed by the road construction.
Okay. So what do you ballpark? 100 maybe?
I would say likely 110 to 120.
Okay. So to be conservative, over and above the industrial land inventory that we have, so we're going to use the proceeds from that. Okay, so let me back to the question of, with changes in the route of the road, what do you expect, what are you projecting that cost will in fact be for the road? I know it's still early stages.
Yeah, that's, I mean, that's too early to put an exact number on. I mean, that would be reckless for me to do that, but we budgeted some numbers. Until the final design and tendering comes in, we'll, we won't know completely, but we think we've got it fairly close with the budget that we have.
Okay, so getting back to the amount of land that we're going to have that is developable, saleable, we are talking about industrial use land,
yep.
Employment land.
Yes.
Okay. So conservative, an additional 100 acres of employment land, and what portion of that do you think is in fact developable and not EP or otherwise unusable? Ballpark.
I mean, let's just say there's, and that would be, I think, a bit aggressive, between maybe ditches through the property and a bit of wetland in one area, you might lose another 20 acres or something. So let's say really, you know, there's 80 acres.
Okay.
And if we were to sell it at 30,000 an acre, that's 2.4 million. You know, the Highway 10 commercial will definitely drive a higher price.
Yeah.
And that whole, in my mind, it won't be an acre out of Highway 10 likely sell for less than 30, because it's a much more valuable asset than the Eco Park lands, for sure.
Well, that's very helpful. Thank you. Christine?
So you, back to, you mentioned that, you know, in 2018 we're hoping to sell a chunk of land for close to $1 million, give us, you know, and you suggest zoning and concept design changes. What is the zoning?
Sorry, I think you better ask for clarity on that question. You said what zoning?
You suggested zoning changes.
Yes.
What zoning?
Well, the developer is looking at putting some residential in that, on that property, so that would require a zoning change. He wants to, Clint doesn't like me using the word, but I will use it anyway. I think he wants to create even more affordable housing that would transition to light industrial type commercial businesses being in that area. So that's a transition that will come before council in time.
Okay. Seeing no miss. Do you have my order? I have my hand up. Prior. If you could just clarify, you refer to industrial land, you're also referring to the Eco Park land. Because we do have an industrial park.
Yeah.
And we have the Eco Park.
Yeah, I'm talking
and
about,
then we're going to have another 140 acres that could be industrial.
Well, yeah, but I'm talking about the industrial classification, not the site specific land.
Okay.
So,
thank you.
Yeah. So
economic development, there's, in 2017, we raised $12,000 from taxation, projecting to spend $13,000. And 2018, there's no special projects anticipated, or we'll continue contribution to reserves for future downtown, future downtown improvements.
So we have a reserve that's specifically dedicated to downtown improvements.
Yes.
Is that what it's called, downtown improvements?
Yes.
And what's the balance in that reserve again?
I don't have that right now.
Okay. Where does the town hall fit in these categories? Is pretty much the category to talk about it?
The old town hall, I would think on the recreation piece, that's where it was presented last year.
Okay. I'm just gonna scan my note here. So what should we anticipate is going to be included in these downtown improvements, right? So we're putting reserves and community improvement plan, downtown improvement, like where's the connection, where's separation? What are we building this reserve to do?
Well, specifically there's a downtown parking lot is one of those downtown improvements, and there's also a general downtown improvements reserve that this specific project hasn't been identified yet. Or determined, decided on. I've heard a few ideas for the ground.
When did we talk about the ideas?
Well, some of this is going to be required. I mean, we've been working at facade improvements for years. That's been in the budget for many years. But downtown improvements, there's going to have to be something done when we redo the water main, because every sidewalk downtown Dundalk on Main Street is going to be lost and replaced. And what do we want that to look like when we put it back together? That's going to mean street light, you know, decorative street lights will be either put back in place or changed and so on. So the fund to put the water main in place on cover those kind of things.
So it sounds like we need to have a vision for the change in line with this water main work.
I would say at this point we want to have cash available to do something, and we need to prepare for it now. What that looks like, we'll need to consult with the downtown businesses between now and then. Will the downtown change? But at least we're prepared to have cash available when we get there.
Thank you. Any additional questions, Barbara?
Thank you, through the chair. Was there any some time ago for the downtown improvements, the facade improvements, there was a program that was offered to downtown businesses whereby they put in a certain amount of money? Was any of the reserves part of that program? So we were setting aside reserves to be available should there be any uptake from downtown businesses? Or is that a separate community downtown improvement?
Yeah, the facade improvement was for the downtown businesses to tap into that funding. We started that process with the idea that there'd be some uptake. There was little interest, and part of the community improvement plan is to implement the rules and the guidelines around that very piece, so that if we contribute money, we don't want somebody painting their building pink and another one painting blue. That downtown improvement full structure is to create a committee so that there's forces businesses to talk to one another and have a theme and a look that's not that's unique but not different from one another, so that there's some consistency and not conflict.
Just to follow up, unless you're Lunenburg and that was their actual
design, pink, orange, blue, green,
yeah,
red. But if we have a program or a theme, Hannah went through a process of working with the community and the businesses to determine, you know, how we would spend funds and what kind of look, what facade. If a new business, if a building were to be sold to a new business owner, would they be required to upgrade their facade accordingly? Or are we looking to mandate any of that?
No, we don't have powers to
thank you
to do that, but we do have, you know, if they're going to make changes, they've got to come and see us, but that all has to be implemented. But right now, they can do as they like. But they're not, we can't empower them to make change because they don't look and feel the same. There has to be, you know, you got to get the horse the water trough, and if they want to drink, they can drink.
But if they're going to take us up on the offer of a contribution, then we have say.
Absolutely. We're there to help them out and make it consistent.
Thank you.
So the community improvement plan, that's something that we're going to hear next from planning?
Yes, planning and economic development will be involved in that.
And ballpark time frame?
2018.
All righty.
I'd like a recess.
All righty. Short recess.
Thank you.
How much is it? Left that money?
What, in the about 25 or so.
And you didn't come up to say it, but how much do you think it's going to cost?
Like 2 to 3 million.
You can raise enough money.
Oh, yeah.
From the sale.
Yeah.
How does this come in?
Again, because we have to line up with
chance of getting a concert going in that Lester Park area? Maybe Highway 10 bypass.
Yeah.
You know, concert going, get a bit of that racket.
Yeah.
Let's have the palace.
He's been to some of the meetings. I don't know why he's not here today, but. Haven't heard anything about that either. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
I did a story on this woman and her B-Tech story.
Yeah.
China?
Yeah.
And asked her where they come from. She said, there's some, you know, some suppliers on the way. And asked her about palace.
Yeah.
We're in discussions.
Yeah.
He supplies it all already.
Doesn't he ever? Yeah.
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 He's got a little extra factory.
Yeah. Doesn't seem like him to turn away from this opportunity. That's gonna be good. So, yeah, I guess, especially some local, that would be.
Oh, it would be great.
Yeah, all around, so.
But I know he has big contracts out of people.
Yeah, whether he has room or not.
And maybe he does now with his properties up in the ground too.
Yeah, and he's got some out to the west too.
Really?
Yeah, and Saskatchewan, I believe.
So what does he do there? Because that's where he brings his cattle.
Yeah, there's somebody out there he's either partnered with or doing stuff together. And that's what sounds like, yeah. So, I just know that a couple of times a year he's gotta go out there for settling up and meetings and stuff and then.
And that's where he is now.
Who knows? All I know is it talks about going somewhere on vacation. No, no. The one in February, I think, is when his wife lays down the law and they go somewhere for a week or two. Yeah.
How's your wife?
Excellent.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Out of hospital?
Yeah. She's coming along great stronger every day. She's been given the go ahead to go to the public now. So she's, her immune system is so stressed that they were worried about that, but she's doing really, really well. Yeah.
What kind of transplant?
Liver.
Yeah. Are you the donor?
No, my son. Yeah.
And they take it apart?
Yeah, they take about half.
Wow.
Yeah. So, yeah.
So in his case, it'll grow back.
His has grown back already.
Really?
And he's back to work full time. Yeah. So probably, he's 34 and probably in better shape than he's been in 10 years.
He probably had to get in shape for that one.
He did. Yeah. He did. He lost close to 100 pounds. And he was, but then the surgeon said with his recovery, you know, he'll all be 34 in perfect health going into the operation.
Yeah. How did he lose 100 pounds? I wonder.
What they did is they looked at him and said, yeah, you're a potential donor, but we want to lose some weight.
Yeah.
And so they said, go on a slim fast diet. And that's all he had.
Slim fast.
Slim fast, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And then.
That's a product.
Yeah. You can buy a can and mix it, or you can buy it in the bottles. And then he worked out every day, but it was slow cardio stuff, like just walking at the gym and stuff like that. No. Yeah. 100 pounds.
You hear that, eh? You knew 100 pounds.
How long did
it take? I think he was 3 or 4 months that he was getting into it. Yeah.
A few years ago, I was 250.
And now you're?
210.
Well, there you are.
I've been staying at 210 for about 5-6 years.
Well, I'm at 200 and plenty, and I'm staying there.
How about her liver?
Yeah, they say, now for him, they said 3 months, and his would be back to normal.
Of course.
But they did an MRI. At 6 weeks, and it was back already. And hers will grow, but it'll take up to a year.
Okay.
Yeah. It is. And like I say, every day you can see the difference. And she was very yellow, and her eyes were yellow and everything. And the night of the operation, I was like,
so.
Yeah.
Well, she'll be back on her feet
too. Oh, yeah. Yep. You know what? Is that whole sleep
thing? That's where he is.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, 2 seconds.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, for sure.
So, are we done in economic development, or are we done economic development, or are we still on that slide?
I don't have any additional questions on this slide at this time.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, so let's move on to the next slide, fire.
No, you lead, I'll just take support.
So in 2018, the budget anticipates a bunker year and PP&E expansion, as well as the purchase of FirePro software, as well as the existing pagers are on a lease, so that's an operating cost, but it's going to be need to be renewed in 2018. So that was listed as a special project.
How many sets of bunker gear? So just to make sure that I'm recalling correctly, we're investing in additional bunker gear every year.
Yeah, bunker gear is based on 10 years per set. We try to spread it over the 10 years that we're not buying 25 sets or 30 sets all at once.
Okay.
And it also depends on past the past certification every year, liners or something, or bunker's damage. Replace it, so, and new recruits coming in after a new bunker year also.
So this year, so last year was the first year that we got back into investing in second set bunker gear, right?
That actually hasn't been coordinated yet. We got the washer coming, and then once that starts, we'll have bunker gear available for. If that gear gets contaminated one night and they have clean gear for the next day and we don't have it washed, it'll be available. I'm going to work with 10 generic sets, just available for that purpose.
Okay, so for 2018, for the first time, we're going to actually have a second set.
Not for everyone, but a generic set that I have.
Okay.
Back set, yeah.
Right. So did we, in fact, buy bunker gear for 2017, or this is the first budget in 2018?
There will be four sets purchased this year.
Okay, so four sets 2017.
And then there always these four sets of either 8 to 10 sets for new in 18.
Okay, so for 2018, we're planning on, is it 4 or 8 or 10?
And 18 here.
I should look at the B reference here, B8.
Okay. If I might interject just to help, hopefully help, and John will correct me if I'm incorrect. So on page 33 of 79 of attachment B, that's where the 2018 budget is. So my understanding is in 2017, we anticipate both of your $32,000, which was basically the full second set expansion of $20,000 coming from restricted reserves. that actually, that expansion didn't happen until 17.
Right.
But the budget now to basically spreading that over 3 years. So instead of buying it all in 1 year in 2017, we're now buying over 3 years, 2018, 19, and 20. And as Don said, the reason that got delayed from 2017 was because we wanted to get the washers in place first before we started buying the extra year.
Okay, so over the course of 3 years, we're spending how much per year?
The budget is $16,000 a year for 2018, 19, and 20.
Okay.
So basically, renewals are about 8,000 a year, and then the expansion is 8,000 a year. So for the next 3 years, we're spending 8 and 8, and then beyond that, it's just the 8.
That's 4 sets.
4 sets, yeah. So roughly $2,000 a set.
Correct.
So $16,000 a 8 set. So 4 would be renewal, 4 would be expansion.
Yes.
So, according to Christine, PPE?
Personal protective equipment.
Okay, thank you.
That's okay. Helmets, boot gloves, belt buckles.
Gotcha. Christine.
Okay, so I thought I recalled that in 2017 we budgeted for that air gear plus washer.
Yes, we did.
Okay, so we didn't spend the money.
The washers, and we haven't, we bought the wall. The washers are on the way, and they're not installed, so yeah.
Correct. There's a process getting.
So, our chief office to get the washers in place before it be expanded in here.
And just to be clear, you did say that you are still expecting to have 4 sets of bunker gear this year, right?
Correct.
Yes, okay. Barbara?
That was my way.
On this chart, I'll go and move on. 2021,
2022.
Walk us through.
Yeah, you go ahead. I don't have all the answers.
So just to go quickly through the 10-year forecast for fire. So the 2018 is basically the expansion of the gear as well as some SCBA air bottle replacement, and hardware software as mentioned, major renewal. In 2019.
So just to be following along more appropriately, we'd be on page 33, right?
Page 33 of 79.
Yeah, okay.
So I mentioned those are the major projects for 2018. For 2019, the continued bunker gear replacement and expansion, more air bottle replacements, as well as a fire pickup squad. Right now there is a pickup truck, and the DC anticipates a second crew cab pickup truck, and the fire chief is proposing that we, instead of buying 2 pickup trucks, buy a squad car instead in 2019 to accommodate for the kids' vehicle, correct?
The pickup currently has got 200,000 kilometers on it, 2002. It's got issues that it's going to be out of service. So I'm saying in our next purchase that we make of a pickup squad that we use on calls and for meetings, combined making a unit that we can use for myself and fire calls.
Does our fleet manager also include the management of the fire department fleet separate? That's just public works?
Just public works, which includes water, wastewater, and
And how many vehicles in the fire department?
There's 2 pumpers, a tanker, and a pickup truck.
2 pumpers, 1 tanker, and a pickup truck.
And a rescue unit. 5.
Okay. So any other, where would we see setting aside funds for the additional bay on that building that we think we want and we'll need in the future? John?
Thanks. I just have one more comment on the vehicles. any frontline vehicles, including the pickup truck, if it's used as a frontline vehicle, it can't be over 15 years of age. Once they are, they can't be a frontline response vehicle, and that's the Ontario law. So it's getting right on the edge there.
Okay, so further to your query, so in 2018, we have a contribution to reserves for infrastructure of $36,000. So as you see, that amount going into reserves fluctuates from year to year because I've smoothed the requirement for taxation to between 2 and 3%. So that reserve being put away for future vehicles or bay expansions. So in 2018 is the fire pickup squad. It's a large, the largest capital purchase that year. And in 2020, there's some jaws of life that's being anticipated, which means it's a deviable item. 2020. And then on the next page in 2021, there's the fire station expansion of one bay, $250,000 being funded from $120,000 of unrestricted reserves and $120,000 of restricted reserves, so DCs. And then as a placeholder, I'm not sure if 2021 is the year it is, but the service agreement with Clinton North Fire, there's going to be a capital component to that. So I've listed that under a special project because to us, it's an operating cost, not a capital cost. But I'm not sure if that was all in one year, but it's presented in that year because I don't know exactly what year it's going to be shown. In 2022, anticipating a rescue water tanker replacement, partially funded by DCs, and then as well as four air packs. And in 2023, no significant capital purchase, but continued contribution to reserves of $35,000. And in 2024, no significant capital purchase, continued contribution to reserves. 2025, no significant capital purchase, continued contribution to reserves. Beginning in 2026, but then in 2027, there is a watch anchor for $400,000, which takes that money out of the reserves and is debt for the remaining piece. So that's how the 10-year fire capital has been presented and attempted to smooth for requirement for taxation.
So if I'm interpreting this correctly, the next time we set money aside for the expansion is in 2020?
The expansion, we're putting money into a reserve. Right now there is a building reserve. I'm anticipating having an infrastructure reserve rather than a building reserve. So there's already money in that building reserve as well as it's being put away in years leading up to 2021. So the short answer is yes. The reserves that are going into reserve after 2021 will be for the rescue pumper and the water tanker.
Okay, so just backing up, what's the difference between an infrastructure reserve and what was the other terminology that you used?
I'm building right now, there's a building reserve. I'm basically the one that championing use of an infrastructure reserve. Like you put money into a reserve, the infrastructure reserve for capital, future capital. So rather than having five reserves for one reserve for each vehicle, let's just have one fire infrastructure reserve, and then whichever asset comes up needing the money first gets that money from that reserve. So that's why I introduced the term infrastructure reserve rather than a building reserve than a tanker reserve.
Okay, so I'm looking on page 34. And I'm seeing fire station expansion one bay, expenditure $250,000, contribution from unrestricted reserves $125,000, contribution from restricted reserves $125,000. So your terminology infrastructure reserve would come into play there when you say taking from reserve, adding to reserve. You're talking about an infrastructure reserve specific to the fire department.
Yes.
Okay. So I just made a note of the interest. maybe just put it this way, at what stage do we anticipate that we would in fact be moving forward to expand the fire station based on this budgeting?
2021, that's when the one bay would be added.
Okay, so 2021, you're showing the expense of 250,000?
Yes.
Okay, and there was discussion about not just the one bay, but perhaps, like, have we budgeted for everything that's going to be included in that extension or other modifications to that facility? Seems to me we had discussion about other things at the same time. I don't know if I'm mixing up the arena and the fire hall, but...
So I think that discussion was around the growth of Dundalk, Public Works, Fire, and is there room to build a bay on the present work garage, or do we build additional bays on the fire hall that may not be the fire hall base? They may be separate units for the storage of a fire or of a fire truck or something like that that would be mobilized at Dundalk. So, you know, we have that flexibility, but that type of addition would be in Jim's budget.
Okay. Okay. Thank you for that. Heather?
Jaws of Life. Do we not have Jaws of Life? I thought we had it. Or is that the replacement of Jaws of Life?
We have them, but they become dated. Cars change, technology. And we're probably 4 or 5 steps behind.
And just, I know I've asked a question when we're talking about the sale of land and, you know, whether we would consider increasing the height. And whenever we do that, the fire department needs to be consulted to determine whether or not at any point in time should we be considering a ladder truck. Or do we have access to a ladder truck through Great Highlands, Durham, or Mount Forest?
We have access to Durham's aerial. I believe we have mutual aid with him, but we also have shares in the truck, I believe. Shelburne and any other mutual aid is Ontario based. They would come, but we would pay annual rates per hour.
So do we share ownership in that unit with Durham?
I don't, prior to this, I'm not going to say for sure, I can find out, but I do know that they will come, they have come to the downtown core mutually. Fletcher does not have an aerial truck. It would either be, it would have to be West Grade, or Sheldon would come at a cost.
If we did have shared ownership in that, would that show up on the asset management plan?
I'm going to backtrack that. I believe that, but I should confirm that before I say that.
And fair enough. But if we did, financial structure would dictate that it should show up on our asset management plan. If we have a shared ownership in any asset in another municipality, would it not?
If it's shared ownership, yes.
Okay.
But not if it's just co-funded.
Yeah.
And with an agreement of its use.
Yeah.
So I believe that's, I'm thinking that's what the...
So shared use as opposed to shared ownership.
Shared use as opposed to shared ownership. Your agreement might allow you to, if you funded the purchase of that truck, you get to use that truck, but if you didn't, then you have the MTO rates to use that truck.
Gotcha. Thank you. Barbara?
So, just that we contributed $1 million to the Mount Forest Arena gives us a seat at the table plus the use of the ice time. It doesn't give us ownership in the asset.
That's correct. It's not me to begin with.
Okay. Anything else to highlight on the fire?
Just the following standards of the fire service on trucks, length of years and stuff that by laws we have to consider.
Are any of the recent discussions that took place relevant to the capital budget? I know some discussions of communications devices and so forth. That would be operating, would it not?
Yeah. Radios.
Yes.
So there really isn't light affect this budget? Capital special projects required?
Not off the bat, I think it's off the bat, no.
Okay. Okay. Please go ahead.
Yep. Next one is recreation. So in 2017, we had raised 125,975, we anticipate increasing that to 229,000. In 2018, again, we go between a little over 2% a year, that's due to this moving with the contribution to reserve each year. So in 2018, we anticipate some parkland development and amenities, soccer field development, as well as that contribution to infrastructure reserve for future replacement of facility, which you'll see in 2027, there's a $15 million expenditure for a multi-purpose facility.
So my first question is, how many multi-purpose facilities are we budgeting for? Because we talked about multi-purpose of the medical, and now we're talking about a different facility, so do we envision two facilities?
From a budget standpoint, we're providing that flexibility because at this point, you know, you can separate, you can bring them together, but ultimately, you know, what the decision of the day will be, I think this is the best way to budget and track it. Something may happen that we won't need one of those, and that can be dropped, but the other one can be advanced without creating confusion in the budget process.
So we have nothing about the old town hall, and we haven't included anything about the old town hall. We have this property that's deteriorating, and we have not addressed it in the recreation budget. Whether that is the potential sale of it, perhaps we should be looking at that, putting it up for sale and seeing what falls out of the tree. Or deciding on its future. It's not, from the, all of the reports, it's not a multi-use facility. It could be a theater if renovations were made, but when it's a township facility, it carries different rules, correct?
Correct. And right now, at this point, we're addressing requirements to operations as far as maintenance and so on, but yeah, that's discussed. And I would say sooner rather than later, that whole issue of its status needs to be reconciled.
So, part-time development and amenities, what does that mean?
My understanding is that we're going to be developing some parkland and amenities, but the specific location and what that's envisioned, it has not been set yet. So we have just $30,000 a year for that process. And any project that does, recreation facilities manager wants to go forward, we'll bring that to council to decide on what to do with that project money.
So I still struggle with what is the vision for parkland and what amenities, where?
So I think there might be some confusion here of what where the developer starts and where the developer stops. Really, the developer really only has to have a commitment to provide parkland or provide money in lieu of parkland. We may negotiate with them further development of that parkland by putting trails through it, but for to have the developer put in further infrastructure like playground equipment and so on, I think our vision needs to be, we need to have control of that so that we manage it and they're not swapping it something that we can't afford or something that's inferior. That's why we collect through development charges for that amenities piece, and and then we spend the money appropriately to our budgeting, our goals, our needs, that we feel as a community is required.
Okay, well, thank you for that. So at what point are we all gonna have a discussion about the vision for what this parkland development will look like?
So I think we've reported already, those discussions are going on right now with the plateau as far as the trail system through that land. They're doing some concept designs of that. Some point when we get further down the road, there'll be land is actually available for parkland development. It'll be in our under our responsibility. We would then, I think, have those discussions with the Recreation Committee and then bring reports to Council as to what would be recommended.
So, at 50,000 feet, we should anticipate that we will have some park-like space within each development. Are we going to have trails going through each development? I'm really trying to get a sense of the bigger picture.
Well,
and so other people can get a sense of it as well, you know, what that vision will be.
I think it's maybe, let's just wait until, you know, we're in a budget cycle that, you know, again, is dealing with the numbers of putting money away to do these things. I'm not sure this is the right time to discuss this. You know, we can report to Council when we do get a concept design, but there is adequate trails to connect those new communities. Definitely in White, in Flatto. White Rose, there was some challenges because it was a pre-existing concept, but we do have connections to the rail trail, and we do have sidewalk connections to the rest of town, obviously, but in their future phases, there is definitely going to be concepts to connect that community better as well. But in the Flatto projects, there is all kinds of streams through the project, and connecting trails will be put through those passages through the middle of the subdivisions and tie in the stormwater areas and so on, that there'll be significant open space, rest areas, and linkages to what I would call natural features around the outside of the project.
Okay, so his last question on this would be, within what time frame would you expect some of these conversations to come back to Council and potentially public for their input?
Likely in the next 6 months or so.
Thank you.
John.
Just to update Council, the Recreation Advisory Committee has been looking at this, and Kevin has got a lot of preliminary plans set up, so this is something that's been ongoing for a while now. No recommendations as of yet, just waiting for the pieces to fall into place a bit.
Thank you. I see no hands. Talked about the big numbers there.
So next slide, library.
For 2018, we are looking at expanding our collection with the special collection, which will be funded through by development charges. And then we're also going to be establishing an infrastructure reserve to separate it from our library restricted reserve, just to better place to focus on setting money aside for our building as opposed for any library use within the library reserve.
So to clarify, we're adding a new reserve account, not replacing. Right?
Correct. Yes.
So we're going to have an infrastructure reserve as well as what was the existing number to us?
A library reserve.
Okay, thank you. Christine?
Well, you mentioned building. So are you suggesting that the building is going to increase in size, or are you building and just maintaining the building?
Yes. sorry, infrastructure reserve would maintain the building, and then you'll see in the future, in 2021, there's a larger sum there for potential renovations in the building. As the need increases with the new growth that's coming, we're hoping to expand within the full potential of the building, which includes the OPP, EDO, and food bank, which is that number in 2021. And then in 2027, there's a larger number should the need be there to expand. But the board also wanted to stress that they're very flexible with our space needs, maybe going to a separate location, or it's not set in stone, those numbers for sure. Ideally, like, the expansion would happen within the building, and then we'll go from there in the future.
I'm trying to get to the B page. So what's the big number again in 2027?
698,000.
So that is for expansion.
Provided the need is there, yes. On our existing facility.
Any other big numbers? This is, so the 698-2027 is the expansion, and the 2021 is
renovation,
mini expansion, if you will.
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay. That's all. Beyond a few things related to like e-resources and expanding our e-book collection, we see again contribution.
So expanding collection, buying books.
Yes.
And that's capital expense?
Yes. Because they are an asset.
Okay. Makes sense. Just an interesting observation. Okay, so no other questions? Christine?
Wait, order.
I'm sorry?
I had my hand up and I put my microphone up when I was missed.
What else? There's absolutely no intent to overlook you at any time.
Well,
so
I understand. That's why this, I think, might help, because Jim and I are blocked from your view when you're looking at the papers or looking at other people, from just the physical nature of how the table that they did. So I wanted to just clarify a couple of things, because we're talking about an internal renovation to expand into the existing space versus an external expansion to make the building larger, whether that's up or out. 2021 seems a little far out. I thought the library board, we had discussed that being more imminent. To, I know that's only two, three years, but would we not, and again, it says 150,000, that number comes to mind. The development charges only have $50,000 amount in DC.
And that's why it's in capital. The other would be raised by taxes.
Okay.
So we are planning to expand into the EDO within 2018 for partial use with the economic development officer. We've got that agreement already approved. So some equipment is budgeted for 2018 as well in there. And then continue on forward. But yes, the board did see 2021 as the date for renovation.
So we have the ability to utilize the space into the EDO. We're not going to tear down the walls. And by 2021, we'll need to address the growth and whether or not OPP remain, the food bank, and that would be where we start moving walls.
Correct.
Christine?
Well, I'm just looking at this 31% increase in 2018. So we're doing another large expansion of the collections that we have. Is that correct? And how much of that comes from taxation? So an additional $11,000 from taxation, is that correct?
No, not, that's not correct. If you look at page 4379, 2018 is at the top of that page.
Just half a second till I get to it.
So in 2017, we raised $8,600 from taxation, and in 2018, we're anticipating $11,340 total from taxation. So that's about a $1,500 increase, which is about 32% for unlettered fees. So of the 1,000,
could you just say that again?
So the right now what's anticipated in 2018 is to raise from taxation $11,340,
mm-hmm.
and in 2017 we raised $8,600 for capital and special projects combined. So which is about probably $1,800 increase, which is 32%. So $1,800 to the library is a 32% increase. Okay? So of the $11,000, that's not just a collection. That is library collection, where the budget anticipates spending $18,500, of which $9,000 would be fees, and $9,500 would be taxation. So of the $11,340, only $9,500 is for the collection.
How much was from taxation last year?
On the previous page, the collection was $8,000 from taxation.
Okay.
So there's the $1,500 increase in the collection. There's your increase in collection.
I know it's on income dollars. It's a large percentage. It just seems like a large percentage. It's a large change. And as we grow, I know we're going to need more. Library got, I believe, like a 10% increase overall last year, and I'm not sure if we're, if it would appear, if it might be heading that way this year.
So what do we anticipate the annual ongoing investments in collection expansion would be? So I'm looking at page 4379, and so 2018 library collections expense shows 18.5. Am I reading that right?
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to spend 18.5 in more books in 2018. And then in 2019, we're going to do it again. So this is pretty much the annual average investment that we can be looking at. Right?
Correct, with an increase over time for accommodating COLA and cost of books going up as well.
Okay. I don't understand the library business enough to think that that's great or not great. That gives you, you know, a turnover of older stuff, and then you're getting rid of the surplus stuff.
So it's like capital for investment has been stagnant for many years, and so I'm introducing an increase gradually over many years again to be able to maintain a collection at a certain level. Previously, with a stagnant number, you're actually lowering value of your collection because you're not maintaining the same levels through meeting and repurchasing. So what I'm doing is introducing an increase over time so that we are maintaining our level of service to existing.
So a thought that comes to mind is in these discussions about, you know, countywide library service or this, the acronym SOLS, what is that again?
Southern Ontario Library Service.
Okay. So when you have a coalition of libraries, if you will, would that include sharing and swapping collections assets would that in fact increase the collection of what's available to our local residents and vice versa? Is that one of the merits of looking at that?
So with our involvement with Soul, they do provide an interest-free loan service. So our patrons are able to borrow books from the library to the other library's discretion. So usually it's not new books or something, or a caveat. And then the countywide system is just looking at simplifying anything that could be simplified over the county. They're not looking at creating a countywide system at this time, as far as I'm aware.
So I'm just, you know, thinking of the ways that a book that, you know, somebody in Durham isn't purchasing the same $50 reference book when there is the availability. And I guess I'm wondering, you know, generally how people are aware of that. So as an example, if I needed a book, or I was looking for a book, I call the library, you don't have it, would you then say, you know what, could be that somebody else does, and that's part of the service, you'll figure out who might have available, so we don't have to incur the investment to satisfy the needs of the residents?
Correct. There's procedures that staff would follow to either find that book for you or refer you to where it could be found. Reference is becoming a more and more an online and digital field, and that's kind of reflected through the computer/e-resources subsidized by DC partially throughout the following years as well. We're hoping to move more of our reference collection to an e-resource, which Soul purchases a consortia on behalf of Southern Ontario Library, so that we get that at the best possible price. But that is an annual subscription fee as opposed to purchasing a new World Book Online encyclopedia collection every year.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what we're moving towards, and that gives a greater access to our patrons as well throughout the township.
Great. Thank you very much. Christine?
Just a quick comment on that interlibrary loan. When I was in Teachers College, the books were anywhere from $150 to $500, $600, and I would call the library and say, can you get me this book? And I could get it for 3 weeks, or usually a shorter time, but enough to get this book and use it.
Mm-hmm.
Occasionally, I don't know if I got to use it, but it was fantastic. It saved me literally, you know, hundreds, if not a thousand or more dollars. So it's a great big process. I'm looking, I have one other question. 2020, I see that the library collection is increasing. It seems to take a jump in 2008. Was it 17? I'm not even going to go there. And then 2020, at the bottom of page 43, the library collections are 19.5, and then in 2021, it jumps to 30,000. And I'm curious why. That's a huge jump.
So that's to accommodate the renovations as well. We're anticipating with the renovations, we'll have more space to add more collections. And then that would follow the book patterns as well, to maintain that same level with our new renovated base.
So the DC, there, it's part of the growth comes from DC. Part of the expense, basically, which you have DC. Do we have any idea how much, typically?
There's a percentage associated with each item there. Collections is about 1 to 2%. E-resources are funded a little lower because their benefit to existing patrons is there already. And furniture is usually covered about 90%. So it depends on the item that you're
talking about. It would be great in the future if we had that percentage. I'll bet it's available for lots of things. It would just be so much clearer.
That's possible. So it is available in the DC background service.
It's just a lot of work for me to go through and hunt. Whereas, you know, DDC and the phone engine, if we had percentage, that would be so fantastically easy.
Okay. So seeing no other questions on library, is there anything else that you want to add? Thank you very much.
provided with a list of what expenditures the department needed each year, and I basically used reserves and debt to sort of smooth the impact year from year to year down to about 6%, given the requirement that Jim had set. I'll let Jim talk to the specifics for that.
So, referring back to the 2017 budget, the side road 15 paving, we put on additional pavement, which we had projected, and had that estimated through one of the paving companies of quantities, and those quantities, when the pavement was laid, were out of whack by quite a bit. So, projecting for the 2018 budget, we have increased that budget for a similar type road project that will take place to accomplish that extra thickness of asphalt. We are anticipating this round for 2018 to do it in a different style. We are going to apply two lifts, two different HL types to accomplish the same result somewhat. What has happened in the 2017 budget is that the overrun of the other capital projects will be taken from the Dundalk projects that were deferred, that some of them didn't transpire or take place. So that is offsetting what happened in 2017. The S-126 bridge is part of the Drain 75 works that are supposed to be constructed for next year. In order to do that, we'll have replacing the two multi-plate culverts on 75 there, just north of 24, will be a similar structure of precast concrete as that was just finished here on 24 as being S-38. The tractor was deferred from the 2017 budget for Dundalk. We need to have that tractor replaced this year. In order to do that to move the plow truck that we were had budgeted in there to the following year, 2019. And we have proposed a vac trailer, which is an $80,000 item, which will assist a number of departments. That's why we've broken it out for a three-way cost split between water, wastewater, and roads. This trailer can do locating, emergency locating. What it does is it's just a smaller size vac type truck, so you can excavate with high pressure water and suck the ground to do your spot locating. It will also assist with sewer main cleanup if need be in an emergency type situation. It will also assist with if a sign, stop sign gets involved in an accident and the post is gone, that we can go out and just back a hole and put a new post in. There's a lot of good opportunities to use this tool, and we look forward to having that in part of the fleet to work with. I'd like to point out in this budget for 2018, in order to accomplish the projects that we did, we have taken our gas tax money and put it into S-126, which means we will have no microsurfacing, no maintenance type pavement applications like we've done over the years because of trying to get the projects accomplished when they're listed.
You said the back trailer was going to be split over three departments, water, wastewater,
and roads.
Roads.
Probably a $30,000 range each.
I don't know when Jim presented it, we get $30,000 in each department. I have now loaded $90,000 in roads, with $60,000 come from the restricted reserves, just so it's one unit in one department being funded by three.
Not clear on that. So Jim said it's being costed over three departments.
Yes.
You're allocating it primarily to roads.
So if you look at page 50 of 79, the back trailer at under about three quarters of the way down, the $9,000 back trailer.
Yep.
originally gonna have $30,000 in each department. I've consolidated that into here because it's a $90,000 back trailer, and then I've got $60,000 coming from restricted reserves, which is $30,000 water and $30,000 wastewater. To recognize that it's even,
oh, I see your note there.
Utilized by more than one department, but it's really one asset, not three things being bought.
So we're using the gas tax money for, you say, S-122?
That's right, yes.
And so is this the first time in a number of years that we don't have gas tax money for, was it microsurfacing?
Correct, or other applications that were done previously but had been discontinued, such as civil service treatment.
So what's the impact of that? That's operating, right?
No, it's still a capital, but it's usually about a $250,000 range of maintenance work that we do to pay payments.
So it's a very, very thin layer of asset on operating into capital, microservices.
It's capital because it extends the life of your asset.
Right. So what we're saying is we're not going to do any of that in 2018.
That's correct, to come up with funds we need for what we have.
And if I was to take a look at it, so we're going to get back to that in 2019? This is just a one-year thing?
There's a couple of places I'd have to double-check here for sure. We do leapfrog it, I believe, in a couple areas over the years to utilize the funds for something else.
Because it, I mean, it's a trade-off. Microsurfacing extends the life of the asset, and we're not going to do that. It's kind of contradictory to the whole principle of investing so we at least extend the life of the asset. So we're picking one versus the other. I'm going to get back to investing to extend the life of the asset next year, right? Jim?
Yeah, and because of our funding opportunities, like we do have an OSIF formula base, that component of the Side Road 15 funding,
mm-hmm.
but there's no other funding at this point unless something comes along for the 2018 budget.
Okay.
With the road slide, I suggest you go on to solid waste. I think Jim's highlighted a lot of the large things in the next couple of years.
Barbara?
To, if you could clarify, you are smoothing out the impact to 6% over the next 10 years by incurring debt. Would we normally be taking debt on, and what's the implication of? Other than being in debt, but can you just explain why we would, if we haven't previously done, taken on debt to manage it, is this a recommended or best practice to close the gap?
Yes, the township has, well, not in the recent past, and I'm not